Good morning, church. Are you ready for the word? I pray so. I pray that you have your Bible out and you can open it up to Isaiah chapters 5 and 6 and follow along today in the word. I pray that you have a cup of coffee and are enjoying this morning, all hunkered down in your house. And I also pray that this message would touch you and your family in a very, very special way. In fact, what I hope and pray is that you're nourishing yourself on the Word of God, because this is what I believe. I believe God's Word speaks to us about any situation that we find ourselves in. The Scripture tells us that His Word is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. And I can tell you that God knew all of this was going to happen in the first quarter of 2020. It didn't take Him by surprise. And I can assure you of one thing, that God has not fallen off the throne because of COVID-19. His Word is living and is active, and it speaks to us today. And I really believe that I have a word that our congregation and perhaps many others need to hear at this moment. So I want you to stay tuned. Last week we got cut off. I'm not expecting that today. If we do get cut off, that's okay. Just stay for a moment or two and perhaps we'll come back on, or catch us later on. You can also catch this a little bit later on up on YouTube. All you have to do is search for Bob Millsaps. That's M-I-L-L-S-A-P-S. On YouTube, and you'll find us there. But we're living in unprecedented times. I've been on this planet for a long time, and I can assure you I've never seen anything like this. Our entire planet is concerned about the spread of COVID-19, as they should be. Of course, our prayers today are with our healthcare workers, our president, Congress, the truck drivers, all those who keep that supply chain going, all the hardworking people in grocery stores and pharmacies, and they all deserve our respect and appreciation. And our prayer especially is with those who fear that they may have been exposed to this virus. And as a pastor today who cares for his flock greatly, I want to encourage you to follow all of the government mandates that are being issued, whether that's national or local. Please stay attuned to all of these things. And I know that many people are at home watching the news, and maybe like me, your emotions during this time have kind of been all over the place. One day you're feeling really encouraged, the next day you're feeling discouraged. And I know there are a lot of people who have lost jobs, others that are afraid of what this might do to them economically, others who are stuck home just feel isolated. Well, I've got a word of encouragement for you today, okay? If you're a believer in Jesus, I want you to be able today, through this message, to literally lift your eyes up into the heaven and realize in your heart that God is still on the throne. Kind of want to set the stage for this message with a question. It's a rather deep question today. We're going to look deeply into the book of Isaiah, and Isaiah prophesied largely to the nation of Judah. I'm speaking to the United States of America. And so what I want to do is kind of connect these two and draw some parallels. So here's my first question today. Is the United States of America in the same spiritual condition as ancient Judah was? Now, I'll be honest with you. I'll never forget the Sunday following 9/11. The churches in America were packed, and our church here at Fountain of Life was packed as well. But amazingly enough, just three Sundays later, it was church back as normal all over the nation. And I can't tell you how much that broke my heart. And I'm concerned for our country, because honestly, I don't want to see a repeat of that. But I know this, that if the spiritual climate in our country doesn't change, we could see that very thing happen when this is all over. Will America's churches be full for a Sunday or two or three, and then will everyone just kind of go back to life as normal? I'll be honest with you that as a pastor here in Houston, Texas, I am more concerned about the spiritual condition of our country than I even am about the coronavirus, because the Scripture tells us this: what does it profit a man if he gain the whole world and yet he loses his own soul? I want to correct some thinking today. There's a lot of people saying that God created the coronavirus. Now, that goes against really what the Word says, because the Word says this: every good and perfect gift come down from the Father in heaven. I don't think God made this coronavirus to cause death and destruction. And what I do believe is that you and I, we live on a planet that's hosting a fallen race. The human race has been fallen ever since Adam walked the earth. And it's because of that fallen state that there is sickness and disease and yes, even death. So this coronavirus is just another part of the fall. It is the inevitable consequence of living in a fallen world. It is creation groaning and crying out. But I can assure you of one thing, and that is this, that our God in heaven is going to use this situation to cause men and women everywhere to think about Him. And hopefully these same men and women will turn to Him. And His Word speaks to this. And as I have studied the Word, I believe that our country is in much the same spiritual condition as ancient Judah was. Let me give you those ways right up front today. First of all, number one, we have been very blessed as a nation. The nation of Judah in the Old Testament was blessed economically. Secondly, most of America has left God out of their lives. Now, that's not true for everybody, but I'll tell you, the amount of people who used to go to church is staggering. And most of Judah, in spite of economic blessing, has turned away from God. And then number three, we are in a moment of national crisis. Our crisis is well known, COVID-19, but it is a crisis. Judah found themselves in a different crisis altogether, but yet it was a national crisis when a great king by the name of Uzziah died. We got to understand this, that in that point in Judah's history, when Isaiah prophesied and walked the face of the earth, they had been extremely blessed. It was a godly king by the name of Uzziah who had sat on the throne of Judah for 52 years. And that great man had brought stability to that nation. The Philistines, their enemies had been subdued under this great leader. And Uzziah had developed the military strength so that they were respected by those in the region. And he had also completed many domestic projects. His name was literally on the lips of those in that country. And to tell the truth, he was kind of like a national hero. The nation looked up to him, depended upon him, and trusted in him. But I'll tell you, here's the very sad part of what happened in Judah. The nation of Judah had not followed his godly ways. Now, I would like to tell you that prosperity always brings spiritual health, but that's just not true. Unfortunately, prosperity does not bring spiritual health to a nation. I wish I could tell you that when the blessings flow into the nations of the world, that they always just respond by giving glory to God and honoring God. But that is not true. It wasn't true in Isaiah's day, and it's not true in our day. Our nation has had incredible economic growth over the last 3 years. God has blessed us. He has cared for us. And while there have been problems in our country, and there always will be problems, I just think it's by the grace of God that in 19 years, we've not had a repeat of the 9/11 disaster that happened in 2001. But this is my question today for the United States of America. Are the people of this country really serving God? Now, I know that there are some are. In fact, millions who do. But there are also multiple millions and millions who have not served the Lord. And so my question is this. Even in the midst of this crisis, are we as a nation turning to God? I hope so. I pray so. That is the desperate desire of my heart. Or are we just so proud that we think that we can handle all of this on our own? But the truth is this. That the bulk of our nation has left God out of their lives. Even though we have been super blessed, and the Word brings out that money and cars and jobs and all of the things that you and I would count as blessings, they can actually cause men and women to feel a false sense of security. They can become lifted up with pride, and they can turn to many people turn to many different types of things to try to satisfy the desires of their life. And I think that that's what has happened in America. Frankly, I'm concerned about this nation. If you were to read the first 5 chapters of Isaiah, you would understand that Isaiah had some extremely strong words to say to the nation of Judah, because his concern was for the spiritual state of that nation. My concern this morning is for the spiritual state of our nation. We need a revival in this country. We need to return back to God in this country. In chapter 5 of Isaiah, Isaiah likened the nation of Israel to a vineyard. The New King James Version puts a title to this passage that is extremely allegorical, and he calls it God's disappointing vineyard. It was a vineyard that was loved by its owner. And there was a wall in the vineyard that surrounded the vineyard, and the vineyard was very protected, and the owner had constructed a beautiful tower in the midst of the vineyard so that he could oversee the vineyard and make sure that the vineyard was well kept and taken care of. And there was a wine press in the vineyard because he fully expected to be able to reap of the joy of a harvest. The owner of the vineyard had planted the choicest of vines. He expected to be able to enjoy the harvest of grapes and the harvest of wine. But all that this vineyard was able to produce was what Isaiah called wild grapes. And Isaiah speaks to the people of Judah in giving that allegory in Isaiah chapter 5 and verse number 4. And these were his sharp and very direct words. This is what he said. He said, "What more could have been done to my vineyard than I have not done in it? Why then, when I expected to bring forth good grapes, did it bring forth wild grapes?" Listen. This wasn't just an allegory with no meaning. He was speaking directly to Judah. He was saying, "What more could God have done for you, Judah? I gave you a good king. I put a hedge of protection around you. I blessed you with rain. I blessed you with economic goods. But all you brought forth was wild grapes." And I think today the Spirit of the living God is asking this same question today in America. God is saying, "What more could I have done for you?" You see, we've been blessed beyond any nation, and yet if we're honest with ourselves, we have not really brought forth the harvest I think that God intended. God, all many have produced is wild grapes, and here's the really sad part. You see, Judah once knew God. They once had experienced the blessings of walking with the true and the living God. And I want you to know that the United States of America, just a few decades ago, was a Christian nation by large, in part, and they had served the Lord. They respected the Bible. They respected God's word and the churches. And let me tell you something, especially during times of national emergency, the houses of worship were filled out with people crying out earnestly to God. And so this morning, I want to lift up my voice alongside the prophet Isaiah and say to the United States of America, what more could God have done for you than he's done for our nation? What more blessings does he need to give? You see, we live in the most prosperous nation that there's ever been. And yet the statistics show that even though Christianity is on the increase in growth around the world, in the United States of America, Christianity and the fervency around it is waning. We have forgotten God. Isaiah chapter 6 and verse number 1, I want to read the first 7 words. It says this, "In the year that King Uzziah died." Now, there's a lot of meat in those words. Isaiah the prophet, who has seen the pitiful and spiritual state of the nation, is now feeling overwhelmed at the death of this man who had brought such stability to the nation. Uzziah began his reign when he was only 16 years old. He reigned for 52 years. That was a long reign. Overall, he was a good king. This is what the word says about him. 2 Kings 15 and 3 says, "And he did what was right in the sight of the Lord, according to all that his father Amaziah had done." 2 Chronicles 26 and 5 says, "He sought God in the days of Zechariah, who had understanding in the visions of God." And notice this phrase. It says, "And as long as he sought the Lord, God made him prosper." And yet the last years of this great king and his life, and in his life, there was some difficulties. The Bible said that Uzziah's life actually ends in a very tragic way. 2 Chronicles chapter 26 and verse 16 says this, "But when he was strong, his heart was lifted up to his destruction. For he transgressed against the Lord his God by entering the temple of the Lord to burn incense on the altar of incense." Now, this godly king knew he wasn't supposed to do that. He knew that that was not his place to do that. But in his mind, he had become so proud, so full of ego, that he felt he could do nothing wrong, that he was just determined to go into the temple and take the place of those who were priests and burn incense. And the scripture tells us that there were 80 valiant priests who stood up against him. Let me tell you something. I don't know about you, but I'm grateful for the valiant men and women of God who stand up against the things, stand up for right and wrong in our world. And they told that king, they said, "Sir, it is not right for you to do this." But Uzziah grew very angry, and even with the very censer in his hand, he began to move forward to burn that incense. And the scripture tells us that God struck him with leprosy on the very forehead, on his very forehead. He broke out in leprosy. I think that that was a pretty obvious sign, being that it was on his forehead, that his very thinking had become corrupted. And so those 80 priests ushered him out. In fact, Uzziah himself wanted to leave that day because he knew that the Lord had struck him, and he was an isolated leper until his death. So to say these words in the year King Uzziah died is really to say a lot. It is to say in the year a great and wise king died. But it is also to say in the year a great and wise king who had a very tragic end died. And so it was this king's death and the tragedy surrounding it that brought the nation, and in particular Isaiah, to a sense of national tragedy. Isaiah had great reason to be disillusioned and discouraged at the death of King Uzziah. And I'm sure he was thinking to himself, "I wonder, where is the Lord in all of this?" And he looked at the throne, and that throne had been a very, very strong throne. And all of Isaiah's life, a godly man had sat on that throne. And now that throne sat empty, and even the godly king who had sat there now had stumbled and now had died. And it seemed to Isaiah that the entire security of the nation seemed to be at risk. Isaiah was well educated enough and had enough spiritual discernment to realize that if Israel and Judah followed God and obeyed the Lord, that blessing would follow. But if they turned away to other gods, that difficult times were certain to happen. Now the country was in turmoil. The king had died. What would happen? And I want you to know that our country as well is in turmoil today. Our government scrambling to meet the needs of this crisis. Churches everywhere are praying and crying out to God, and that's a good thing. We're literally under attack by coronavirus. But the feelings of this crisis that we're experiencing today is very similar to the feelings of the crisis that Isaiah must have felt in that day. He was saying, "Where is God in all of this? What will the future hold? What's going to happen to the nation?" And those are the same questions that you and I are asking. While our situation is not exactly the same as Isaiah's situation, I can assure you of one thing. The solution is the same. And that brings me to the second question that I have for you today. Will our country do as Isaiah did and really seek the Lord? Isaiah was feeling the weight of the nation, its spiritual condition, its impending crisis. And Isaiah, driven by feelings of discouragement and despair, goes into the temple. And I believe that he went there with just one purpose. He needed an answer. He needed God to speak. The idea of Judah being without Uzziah on the throne bothered him. And so he goes into the temple, and maybe he's fasting. Certainly he's praying. And he knows that the very Shekinah presence of God dwells in the temple in the Holy of Holies. And so he's getting his physically close to God as he can. And so let's read Isaiah 6 and verse number 1 again. It says this: "In the year that King Uzziah died, Isaiah said, I saw the Lord sitting on the throne." Oh, wow. That's exciting, church. In other words, in the year of trouble, in a year of uncertainty, in a year when people were not following God, Isaiah had a revelation of God. He had a vision of God. He said, I saw the Lord. I believe that it's time for the church of the Lord Jesus Christ to stop looking down and stop feeling defeat and to lift up their eyes and say, "Listen, I see the Lord, and he's still high and he's still lifted up and he's still sitting on the throne." And I can tell you today, my friend, that our God isn't worried. He's not stressed out. He is sitting high and lifted up. And this is what I want to say to Fountain of Life today. May the spiritual books be opened one day. And one day may they read like this: in the year of the coronavirus, Fountain of Life Christian Center and its friends looked and they saw that the Lord was still high and lifted up and sitting on the throne. If there's anyone here who understands anything about warfare, then you'll appreciate this. My friend, if you hold the high ground, it's my understanding that you're in a good position to defeat the enemy. Now, I got news for anyone who wants to fight God. You're never going to defeat an omnipotent, omniscient, almighty, all-powerful God. Come on. I'm just here today to tell you. But I want you to understand today that our God holds the high ground. Amen. Someone said, well, isn't his presence at the bottom of the ocean? Yes, it is. His majesty and his splendor are so great, you can find his presence even at the bottom of the ocean. But I'm going to tell you today, that's not where his throne is. His throne is in the highest place in the universe, on the mountain of the Lord. Come on, somebody. He sits enthroned today. And the Bible tells us that not only is his throne high, but he's given a name to his son, Jesus Christ, a name that's above every other name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee's going to bow and every tongue is going to confess that Jesus Christ is the Lord. There's no sickness or disease that has a higher name than Jesus has. There's not a president or a ruler or an emperor that would attempt to give him orders. Come on. Our Jesus today sits enthroned at the right hand of the Father today. And I'm here today to tell you that if God is on the throne, he is ruling and he is reigning. And then, and this is what he has. He has your good at heart. I'm telling you, he didn't set you up to leave you. He said this: I will never leave you or forsake you. He has not abandoned you. He has not abandoned his church. He's not abandoned his people. And I believe he hasn't abandoned the United States of America either. Why? Because he's a faithful God. He's in control. So if we learn anything from this crisis that we're in, let us learn that our God is sovereign and that he rules and he reigns and he's always in control. And I'm here to tell you that he's God on the mountain. He's God on the valley. Come on. He's God in the good times and he's God in the bad times. He's a God in times of famine and the God in times of plenty. He's God when the stock market's up. He's God when the stock market crashes. Come on. I'm telling you that his plan for you and for me is to bring you through this crisis to the other side, shouting the victory, trusting in him all the way. Even in Isaiah's day, there was a godly remnant that said, as for me and my house, we are going to serve the Lord. And they came through spiritually victorious. We are not afraid, my friend, because our God reigns. Let me read it to you again. It says, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne high and lifted up. And it goes on to say that the train of his robe filled the temple. The only modern image that I can think of that kind of expresses what that means is I think of a great royal wedding. And I think of the bride coming down the aisle, and behind her, she has this incredibly long and beautiful ornate train that she's dragging along behind her. And even though the train is beautiful, it's not really about the train. The train just magnifies and amplifies the beauty of the bride. And what we have here is a picture of heaven reaching down and touching earth. And I'm here today to tell you that our God can touch the earth. And let me tell you, we have been slowed down by our Lord. He's caused us to find ourselves with more time on our hands than we usually have. And I want to encourage you, my friend, to seek the Lord with all of your heart, to go out and find a place to pray and to call out upon the Lord. Because let me tell you something. Heaven wants to touch the earth. He wants to surround you and fill you with the train of his glory. Come on. And I believe that you and I, as we seek his face and we look to him during this hour of national crisis, my friend, we can have a fresh revelation of our God, that he is a powerful and a lovely and a wonderful God, and he reigns upon the earth. Isaiah went on to describe him and what surrounded that throne. Isaiah 6 and verse 2, he says, above it stood seraphim. Each one had six wings. With two he covered his face, and with two he covered his feet, and with two he flew. And one cried to another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." And the very posts of the door were shaken by the voice of him who cried out, and the house was filled with smoke. I don't know if you can have an imagination, but I do. I can imagine these heavenly creatures, these angelic type beings, these seraphim with six wings, huge, powerful creatures, and they're surrounding the throne of God. And yet, even as glorious as they are in the majesty of the presence of the Almighty One, they must cover their face with their wings and cover their feet with their wings. And they constantly cry, "Holy of holies." They recognize who he is, that he is the Lord of hosts. All of the many angelic beings of heaven are at his disposal. And at his voice, as he spoke, the sound was so great that the very posts and the pillars of the temple began to shake and the house was filled with smoke. Let me tell you something, our country and our churches need a new revelation of the holiness and of the power and of the splendor of the God that we serve. And that revelation needs to start with you and me. It starts with us as the church, as seeing him for who he is. And so I want to encourage you to cry out to the Lord like never before. And I want you to allow him to reveal himself to you. You know, there are a lot of people today. You see, the coronavirus is God's sledgehammer, and that somehow God's ready just to pound this world down. And yes, I'll be the first to tell you that as a nation, we're far from God. I'll be the first to tell you that we need to return to the Lord. But I'll be the first one as well to run to you and tell you that our God is a God of love. Our God cares about people. He loves people. The scripture says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life." I can assure you today, my friend, that our God's heart is to forgive. Our God's desire is to cleanse. Our God's desire is to bring back hope. And God's heart is that every one of us who follow him would know his power and his glory. Isaiah was overcome in that moment as that glory filled the temple, the seraphim and the shaking and the holiness and the glory of God. And he becomes suddenly aware of our own sinfulness. Let me tell you something, there's one thing that every one of us can do. I don't care who you are, how long you've served the Lord, maybe to get alone by yourself and take a personal inventory of your life about how you and the Lord are really doing. It's important that we examine ourselves today. Isaiah chapter 6, 5, "So I said, woe is me." This is Isaiah talking. He says, "Woe is me, for I am undone, because I'm a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. My eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." You say, "Pastor Bob, what is it that God really wants of us today?" Let me tell you what he wants, an honest confession. He simply wants us to acknowledge our state before him. And maybe you're okay. Maybe you and the Lord are really good, and I pray so. But maybe there's some people that are listening to me today, and you know that in your spiritual life you've slipped away. Or maybe you've left God completely out of your life. And you have to say to the Lord in this moment of national tragedy, you need to say, "I am undone. I am not right. I am a man or a woman of unclean lips." And the beautiful thing is that God immediately took it upon himself to go and to cleanse Isaiah. Isaiah 6 and verse 6 and 7 says this, "Then one of the seraphim flew to me, having in his hand a live coal he had taken from the tongs off the altar. And he touched my mouth with it, and he said, 'Behold, this has touched your lips, and your iniquity is taken away, and your sin is purged.'" Listen, I have some very good news for you today. Our God in heaven has already taken upon himself to provide a way for cleansing, to provide a way for forgiveness, to provide a way for healing, to provide a way of restoration between mankind and God. And that is that he sent his only son to the earth. You don't have to wait for some angel to appear before you in a vision with a live coal. No, sir. All you've got to do is trust in the shed blood of Jesus Christ. The Bible says that today is the day of salvation. And I believe that God is speaking out to many on Facebook Live today. He's calling out to many, and he wants for people to turn to him like never before. Listen, God didn't have you watch this live broadcast by coincidence. I believe he's calling your name right now. Let me tell you, who do you want to be? You want to be one of those that turn to him, that are on fire for the Lord? You can be that. I want to read one more section of Isaiah 6 today, and then we're going to pray. Isaiah 6 and verse number 8. Also I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send, and who will go for us? Then I said, here am I, send me. Here am I, send me. Let me tell you something. God is looking for those who will serve him. God is looking for those who will call out upon him and live all the rest of their days serving the Lord. That's the call that has been given by the Lord. You know, there's a lot of people who believe in a 911 call. And I'm going to tell you something. Don't get me wrong. God answers those kind of prayers. God hears you when you're in a place of emergency, a place of distress, when your world's crumbling and falling apart. God will hear those prayers. But if you really want to know the desire in the heart of God, is that he wants to have a relationship with you. And he wants to walk with you and know you deeply. And you know him deeply. He wants to become your best friend and confidant. He wants to be there for you. And I'll tell you, those are the things that the Lord revealed to Isaiah in that moment of Judah's history. And I pray that these are the same things that God wants to reveal to us today through this message. God is still on the throne. God has provided a means of cleansing, and God's looking for someone to serve him. Listen, if you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, I want you just to send me a personal message on Facebook. I'd like to pray with you today. Would you just bow your heads today? Heavenly Father, I come to you today. And I pray, God, for those who are listening to this broadcast, if there's anybody here who's drifted away, who's backslid, who doesn't know Jesus Christ, and Lord, they're looking at this situation that's all around them and fear has them engulfed. Lord, I pray today that you would come into their life and give them the peace that they need. And Lord, I just pray that they would pray this prayer. If you need Jesus to come into your life, would you just pray this prayer? Say, dear Heavenly Father, I know I'm a sinner. I'm a man or a woman of unclean lips and eyes. I've seen things and done things that I shouldn't have done. But today I need you to forgive me of those things. So Lord Jesus, right now, with my mouth, I confess the Lord Jesus Christ as my Savior. And in my heart, I believe that you rose Jesus from the dead. And today I pray that you would come into my life, not just as a 911 call, not just to rescue my family from this hour of crisis, but Lord, that I might serve you for the rest of my days. And Lord, I make that commitment to you in Jesus' name. Amen. I'd like to pray for our nation. Would you join with me today? Wherever you're at, would you just bow your heads, lift up your hands, and would you call out to God? Would you use the words of your own voice to pray for the United States of America? I want to pray for our great country. Heavenly Father, I pray for this great nation of the world. Lord, I pray, Lord, and I'm so grateful today for all the good things that you've given us, all the blessings of God. Lord, the bountiful resources that we've had. Lord, the blessings of God, the economics, God, the way you've blessed us in this nation, Lord. God, you've been so good to us, and Lord, we want to come back and tell you thank you, thank you, thank you for those things. And Lord, I just pray, Lord, that you would hear the cry
supply of your people today. Lord, because we need for you to come and to cause this virus to relent in Jesus' name. And Lord, we as the church of Jesus Christ bind that thing in the name of Jesus, because your word says what's ever bound in heaven will be bound in earth. And so we bind it in Jesus' name, and we come against it right now. God, we pray that you'd give our governor and our president and our mayor, God, all the wisdom that they need. And God, be with our medical people, Lord. And God, everyone who's out there trying to keep this thing going, Lord, in our country, I pray, Lord God, that you would cause, Lord God, today a great revival to sweep across this nation. Lord, we need a move of God. We need you to come today. And Lord, our voice will not be silent any longer. Lord, we will lift our voice and we will cry out to you, because Lord, we confess to you today that you are our only hope, that you are our only stay, and we trust in you today. God, we cling to you. We cling to that old rugged cross. We cling to the hope that we have in Jesus Christ. Lord, we make up our mind that we will not fear, but we will advance in faith. We will walk in faith, and we will see the future as better and more victorious, Lord, because we serve the true and the living God. Be with us today, in Jesus' name, amen. Listen, thank you for listening to this broadcast today. We love each and every one of you, and I can hardly wait until we can all come back together. We won't have to stay 6 to 10 feet apart. We can hug one another's necks like we normally do. We love each and every one of you. God bless you. Stay home. Stay safe. Be with one another. Enjoy life as much as possible. Fix a nice Sunday dinner. This is the Lord's Day. It's supposed to be a day of rest. Take a Sunday afternoon nap. We love each and every one of you. God bless you. Thank you for joining in. Thank you so very much.